Okay, well, hello, and thank you for joining us. I'm David Madison, the Associate Curator of Education and Outreach at the Orlando Museum of Art. Today's presentation is the first in our Cultural Conversations Distinguished Speaker Series. These programs are organized to complement the exhibition, A Boundless Drop to a Boundless Ocean, a collaboration between the Orlando Museum of Art and the American University in Cairo, which is on view through May 2nd. This beautiful exhibition features the work of 21 artists of Arab and Iranian heritage, and we have organized a variety of virtual programs for audiences of all ages as extensions of the show's core themes. To learn more about these programs, visit omart.me/boundlessprograms. Many thanks to the exhibition's lead curator, Dr. Shiva Balagi, for her assistance with organizing today's program. As a brief overview of our Zoom classroom, please use the Q&A feature to ask questions of our speaker. We will address these at the end of today's program. The chat feature is where you may make informal comments. We'd love to hear from you. Go ahead and get the conversation started, introduce yourself, and share where you are joining us from, again, in that chat feature. Now, I have the honor of introducing our speaker. Liana Aghajanian is a journalist based in Detroit and Los Angeles with work published in the New York Times, BBC, The Atlantic, and other outlets. She has reported across the US and internationally. Born in Tehran, she grew up in Los Angeles after coming to the US as a refugee with her family. Liana's Dining in Diaspora is a multimedia project documenting the Armenian experience in America through food. You may learn more about her project by visiting diningindiaspora.com. Liana, thank you so much for joining us today.
Hi, thank you for having me.
Absolutely.
Perfect. All right, so I can start now, right? Wonderful. So thank you so much, everybody, for joining me today, and especially thank you to the Orlando Museum of Art team, especially Dr. Shiva Balagi, for curating this exhibit that this talk is a part of. I am a journalist of Armenian descent. I was born in Iran, but I grew up in California, and I've been tracing the Armenian diaspora experience through food for several years now. As I'm sure it is for many of you, food has always been a way for me to connect with my background, ask questions about the world, my place in it, and think about what the future means. And for me, especially when it comes to the future of what Armenian communities mean in the diaspora. This project really took shape when I received an opportunity to move to Detroit. And that's where I started cooking with a local Armenian women's guild, and documenting how Armenian communities for the last 100 years have really regenerated themselves through food in this country, but also left a very important mark on the American culinary landscape while doing so. And with that theme, I started to realize that cooking was, and telling stories about cooking was not just sustenance, but a very revolutionary act, especially given the history that Armenians come from. It's a resistance, form of resistance, and it's how we keep our culture going. So the Armenian story is really long and complicated, and it has a lot of details, but today I'll concentrate on a couple different stories throughout time in relation to food and give you an overview. And it's a little bit an incomplete story because there's so much there, but hopefully it should give a foundation to how Armenian food has left an impact in America and what that legacy means. So I'll start with sharing my screen. Okay. So, there we go. So who are Armenians? Armenians are an ethnic group that is native to an area that Armenians call the Armenian Highlands. That's often classified in Western Asia. They're a population that is indigenous to a region that now encompasses countries like Iran, Georgia, Turkey, and the present-day Republic of Armenia. So on the left-hand side, just to show you a visual representation of kind of how old Armenian history is and what makes it so complicated, are the different areas of what was considered Armenia throughout many thousands of years. You can see that it spans a very wide range. The red and yellow little areas are basically what the Republic of Armenia is today. And so there was a large, very huge area in which Armenian populations lived and which was considered Greater Armenia at one point. But right now it's around that little red and yellow area. And so today there are 10 million Armenians in the world. And even though it's such an old community, it is still going through dynamic changes. And as you can see on the map on the right, the geographic regions in which Armenians, as well as many other populations lived, is where the first agricultural revolution took place. And this is an area that's often referred to as the Fertile Crescent. It's where 11,000 years ago, humans stopped hunting and gathering and became sedentary and started to domesticate crops and animals. And this is the area in which that kind of sedentary lifestyle spread and agricultural revolution spread throughout the rest of the world. So this map, you can see areas of the Ottoman Empire in which Armenians lived. Armenians have always been at the center of warring empires and kingdoms, and they've been conquered over millennia by many empires, Byzantines, Romans, Persians, Russians, Turks. They lived under Ottoman rule for 500 years, and they really, like many other populations of that time, really contributed and shaped the socioeconomic life of the empire, as well as the culinary life. In and around the turn of the 20th century, that kind of all started to fall apart. The Armenian population in the Ottoman Empire, as well as the Assyrian and Greek populations, were subjected to a systemic mass slaughter where over 1 million people were killed. And today that is called the Armenian genocide or the Assyrian genocide that is often referred to. And so this was the event that really changed Armenian identity and existence in the modern era. Armenians were subject to ethnic cleansing, but it wasn't just slaughter, it was the vast dispossession of wealth, of culture, of knowledge, and that along with that is agricultural knowledge. And what this basically did was that it disconnected Armenians from their ancestral lands forever. They lost a lot of their culinary heritage and cultural heritage. And all that remained were the memories that they took with them. And they found refuge in places like Beirut, Aleppo, Tehran, Europe, and the US. They were influenced by the cuisine of their adopted homes, whether it was certain dishes or certain flavors. And they started introducing cuisine in the form of restaurants, cafes, and new food into the mainstream. So in this next map, you can see the deportation routes in which Armenians were subjected to, whoever survived was subjected to being deported. And you can kind of see the relative numbers of Armenians that were massacred, the deportation control centers and the deportation stations and where all of that took place. So I show this map just because this history is really important when we're talking about Armenian food, as well as just general Armenian history, but also to kind of highlight that the Armenian case is a little unique in the sense that this was, you know, a forced dispersal rather than chosen. Coming to America was not normally a choice. It was because Armenians did not have a choice. And so being in these places, whether it was the US or elsewhere, culinary heritage was often used as a link to connect themselves back to the areas that they were originally from. So One of the first ways that Americans started to learn about Armenians was through a catchphrase known as the Starving Armenians. So forced starvation is a crime under international law. It has been used as a political tool against many populations, including Jews during the Holocaust, as well as the Herero genocide in Namibia and in Ukraine during the Holodomor. In the Armenian case, it was a policy exercised after massacres. Whoever was left or survived of the civilian population were forced on death marches across the desert and slowly succumbed to starvation. But one of the things that emerged during this time was the Near East Foundation in response to these issues of starvation, which was once called the Near East Relief. And that was an organization that developed in America. It's the oldest non-sectarian international development organization. And it was founded in response to the Armenian and the Syrian genocide. They actually still exist today. And they gathered around and rallied around to really save the lives of these refugees through aid and other forms of help. And so here you can see Armenian refugee children in Iraq, in a refugee camp in Iraq. And these are Armenian orphan refugee children from the genocide in Lebanon. And here are some memorabilia from the new Near East publication that the Near East Relief put out. You could have bought, Liberty Bonds, and these are actual meals of the Near East orphan that were published by the Near East Relief Foundation's museum. And so this is really how Americans first got to know Armenians, through the phrase starving Armenian. And when the campaign ended, the phrase kind of stuck, and it morphed from a call of international relief into a euphemism for hunger. And so a lot of mothers in kitchens across America would warn their children to clean their plates and remember the starving Armenians. And it's a phrase that began appearing in newspapers, magazines, and even ads. During this time, Americans would raise money by having dinners, and they would call them golden rule dinners, and sometimes they would serve Armenian food. And so this is an early example of two participants in a golden rule dinner very much enjoying Armenian pilaf. Armenian pilaf, they like it. I just thought that was really funny. So as I said, the phrase started appearing in magazines and newspapers, and one of the places they appeared in was an ad for General Electric refrigerators. I don't know if you can see the text here, but it says basically that this refrigerator will store meals for you and keep them safe until they're ready for confiscation by your quote hungry Armenians. So that's how widespread this phrase became. And on the right hand was a piece I wrote several years ago about how a lot of Armenians, and the phrase stuck until the 1980s. And so it was just interesting for a lot of Armenians who were growing up in the US, where they would go visit their parents' house and the parents would still refer to them as starving Armenians. And so this was a piece all about how it was very confusing for new generations of Armenians who knew that they came from a very rich food culture to be called starving Armenian, when in fact they had more food than other families, I'm sure, on the block, because normally Armenian families have a minimum of at least two refrigerators in their houses with frozen food that they've handmade. So just a very confusing time, I think, for new generations who were growing up. An interesting thing related to this is that last year, when we all were in the beginning stages of the pandemic, for April 24th, which is the day that Armenians commemorate the genocide, 1.5 million meals were provided to commemorate the 1.5 million lives lost during the genocide by a coordinated event from Armenians all over the US. And it was for Feeding America. So that was an interesting thing that happened last year. So briefly, I will just give you a little information about what Armenian food is. It's a living, dynamic, and changing food culture. It's a reflection of a diverse history and vast geography associated deeply with joy and pain. And it has a lot of different meanings depending on who you ask. So my family's from Iran. I'm going to have a very different answer of what Armenian food means to me than someone who was born and raised in the Republic of Armenia and someone who is also a third generation Armenian American. But it relies on freshness and quality of ingredients. It's labor intensive and often made in groups and a gateway to evoke inaccessible heritage. Here are some photos. Some of the food is recognizable in other food cultures too. We have to remember that food obviously does not have borders in the real sense that we think of them today. And so a lot of this is repeated in the Middle East, in the Levant. A lot of other cultures have food that are similar to Armenians. The differences come into play when you're talking about methods of creating things, spices used, ingredients used. That's when things start to differ and you can see the differences between communities. So strange orchards, familiar fruit. I will go through three stories that relate to that theme, but I will explain why I decided to call it strange orchards, familiar fruit. And that is because mostly of a poem about exile and longing, which are big themes when it comes to the Armenian story. This was a poem that was written in the end of the 19th century, early 20th century. And it kind of talks about how the narrator is a quince bush. On the left hand, you can see quince being cooked that has been uprooted and transplanted into a stranger's orchard. And though they're feeding him well with sugar water, he longs to go back to his own soil and be watered with the water of the snows. And so this is a very common theme when it comes to the Armenian experience, whether it has to do with food or just general exile and longing for a homeland that Armenians can no longer access, Armenians were cut off from, is common. And so, in addition to that theme about fruits and agriculture, you can't talk about it without talking about the impact Armenians have had in the Central Valley of California, particularly Fresno. This is an early example of that. The Seropian brothers were, I believe, the first family that settled in Fresno. They were pioneering in the packaging and shipping of dried fruits in the US, mainly dried figs and raisins. They even started to ship their products by mule and wagon after the Southern Pacific Railroad raised its charges. And so it was a really pioneering act to be at that time packaging dried fruit. Here's another example, the Arakelian brothers. They were known as the Melon Kings of America. In the 15th century, the cantaloupe was actually brought to Italy from Armenia and named after Cantalupo, which is a city near Rome. And the cantaloupe started to enter America. It was called the muskmelon because of Armenians who commercially introduced the fruit and started farming it in California. And the Arakelian brothers were known as the Melon Kings of the time. So let's see. These are just some examples of the continued melon escapades that Armenians had in California. On the left is a grower who was just experimenting with very different kinds of melons. And that I believe that's his daughter on the left-hand side. And on the right-hand side is a fruit label. Levon is an Armenian man's name, and it looks like whoever produced this was also named Levon, judging by the text on the bottom, L.M. Azderian. And so these are just some examples of the melon industry and the impact Armenians have had in introducing the fruit to the country. Then there was Henry Markarian, who was a fig pioneer. You might have heard of the Kalamurna fig, which is a combination of the words California and Smyrna. Henry Markarian is responsible for cultivating this fig in the Central Valley And if you find it in your supermarkets today, it's because of his efforts in the Central Valley that led to the creation of this fig variety. And you can't talk about Armenians without talking about raisins in the Central Valley. This is one family, the Chuljian family. They were raisin industry giants. They are still in operation today, running a company called the Delray Packing Company. It's no surprise because Armenians have been farming grapes, making raisins and wines for thousands of years. In fact, the oldest winery was actually discovered in what is now the Republic of Armenia, and it is said to be around 6,000 years old. This is another family, the Sahabjan family, who are proprietors of Victor Packing. They're the world's largest producers of golden raisins. And so these are just some examples of the kind of longevity and influence Armenians have had in making Fresno really one of the largest agricultural areas of the country. And I thought this was very cool. Even in your Kellogg cereal, you can find raisins that are farmed by Armenians. This is Jackie Grazer. She's still farming the same land worked by her Armenian immigrant grandfather. And these raisins go in raisin bran. So to give you a very interesting example of another kind of melon, which is not, it's called a cucumber, but it's actually a melon. It's the Armenian cucumber. You might've heard of it, but I just found it a very interesting way to tell the Armenian story, because before Armenians started arriving in the US, people didn't really know what this was. And it had names. Armenians called it a specific names, as did other populations of the region they were from. But because Americans got introduced to it through Armenians, in the US, it's called the Armenian cucumber. And if you go try to find seeds for it, it just says Armenian cucumber, even though other populations have different names for it. And it started making appearances in American newspapers in the 1940s and 50s and 60s. And people were just shocked at how large it would grow. Here's one example. Here's another example of children in Phoenix, Arizona, who had grown an Armenian cucumber that was 48 inches long. I just found it really interesting that this is another way that Armenians have influenced agriculture in the US and kind of become part of an American cultural legacy. An Armenian cucumber salad that I actually made. Again, the name is a misnomer. It's actually not a cucumber, it's a melon, but because it looks kind of like a cucumber, it took on that name. This is a really interesting story. These are photos of the Jermak family, which is headquartered in Detroit. They're the oldest pistachio roasting company in the US, founded in 1924. They were the first to import pistachios and dried nuts like that into the US. But one technique they had in differentiating themselves was they would dye the pistachios red, and so they became known as red-lipped pistachios. And here's a newspaper advice column that says, "I've got this pistachio problem. I love them, but it seems like hours, even days before the red stains wear off my fingers. Isn't there a quicker way to get the red out quicker?" And so that's how they kind of differentiated themselves, that you knew that if the pistachios were red, they were from Jermak's. And it's a place that I visited often since I've been in Detroit. So before we move on to the next section, I just wanted to share a little musical interlude. Some of you might know this song. It is "Come On to My House" by Rosemary Clooney, but I don't know if everyone knows that the roots of it are Armenian. It was written by William Saroyan and Ross Bagdasarian. And it is based on an Armenian folk song, but if you listen to the lyrics, you start to understand why it's so Armenian, because all they're talking about is, "Come over to my house so I can feed you, and so that I can feed you some really good fruit like plums and pears and apricots and pomegranates. And so this is a promo photo for the song. On the left, on the right-hand photo, you can see William Sorian to the left and Ross Bagdasarian in the background, who is also responsible for introducing the chipmunks to the US, but that's for another presentation. And I just wanted to play, if it loads, a bit of the song so that you can hear it.
Come on to my house, I'm gonna give you candy. Come on to my house, I'm gonna give you apple, a plum, and a pomegranate too. Come on to my house, come on. Come on to my house, come on. Come on to my house, I'm gonna give you peach and pear, and I love your hair. Come on to my house, come on. Come on to my house, come on. Come on to my house, I'm gonna give you candy. Come on to my house, I'm gonna give you everything.
So I thought that was a great way to wrap up the agricultural section. Now we'll move on to how Armenians influence the restaurant industry of America. And the most famous and influential man who did that was George Mardikian, whose restaurant Dinner at Omar Khayyam's was very, very influential in that space. So for over 50 years, George Mardikian stood at the helm of Omar Khayyam's, his world famous restaurant in downtown San Francisco. And customers from everywhere came to 200 Powell Street to not just eat shish kebab and dolma, but to mingle with the energetic and passionate Mardikian, which Life magazine once referred to as the most favorable man in America. So he was an Armenian American immigrant who escaped the genocide, found his way to the US, and revolutionized Middle Eastern cuisine in America, which at the time was a big deal because commercially, the kinds of food that Armenians and other Middle Eastern populations of that region were, did not exist in the US. And so it was a big deal. You can see the restaurant on the right-hand side on a sign that says Omar Khayyam's, which he obviously named after a poet, a Persian poet. And he operated under the motto, the food of good quality. And he had a very interesting escape to the US. A friend of his found him and insisted that he was American. And that's really how he escaped, by faking American citizenship. And so in his writing, he always says, I became an American before I became an American. So he led this restaurant, and he wrote this book, which is a wonderful book based on a lot of his recipes and travels. And on the left is one of the recipes, is the book on the right-hand side of that photo, but on the left is one of the recipes I've made. Some of you might be familiar with halva. This was his version of it. And this is a photo I took, but just to give you an example of the penetration he had in terms of how much he affected American cuisine. This is a piece from a newspaper in Detroit, and it talks about how this person saw the Armenian sausage delicacy and that she had met it through the George Mardikians. And in the end, she says, your real name is Bastrama and your acquaintance for taste is something worth making. And so he was very, very pioneering in introducing a lot of the foods that people of the region that Armenians were from were eating. Shish kebab, dolma, pilaf, dozens of other dishes that would be considered exotic at the time. And he also did a lot to change the food culture of the US Army as well. He kind of revolutionized that area as well. And these are just some examples of George Mardikian in his restaurant with a flaming shish kebab and a very surprised patron. He got a lot of press. You know, this is the Oakland Tribune. Martikian has made his mark. And when I interviewed his son, he told me that he was just such a force of nature and that he just would not sleep. And that's how we got a lot done. But there is a very poignant quote of his actually at Disney's Epcot Center, where he talks about his history and the success that he's had in the US. And it says, one moment you belong with your fathers to a million dead yesterdays, the next you belong to a million born tomorrows. And so really that encapsulates the Armenian experience and the polarization of that experience, where on one hand you have complete annihilation and extermination, and then resistance and resilience in the face of it all. And another story that is like Martikian's about how Armenians entered the culinary space that went beyond agriculture. This is actually more of Omar Khayyam's. I forgot I had the slide, but yeah, so these are little notes of appreciation from movie stars at the time, and it got turned into an ad. And on the left-hand side is George Mardikian teaching some Boy Scouts how to properly make shish kebab. But what I was rushing towards was the story of Almond Joy, which many of you might not know has Armenian roots, and I'll kind of explain that story a little bit. So Almond Joy was created by six Armenian immigrants who escaped the Ottoman Empire and came to the US. They fled just as large-scale hostilities were increasing against the Ottoman Empire's Armenian community. And they settled in New Haven, Connecticut, where this is Paul Halajian. He found work in the area's rubber factories at the time. And when he finished at the rubber factories, he would go and sell confectionery. And he started off selling ice cream. But he had bigger dreams. And so he got together with a group of his friends, and including a chemist, and they decided to come up with the Almond Joy bar as we know it today. I'll show you some early wrappers of Almond Joy and Mounds. So they were responsible for both. Mounds came first, and then it was Almond Joy. But very, very interesting. These are some more ads. Sometimes you feel like a nut, sometimes you don't. That was a famous Almond Joy phrase, but a very interesting piece in a newspaper I found was that during World War II, when Americans caught a Nazi prisoner of war, they found a box of Peter Paul Mounds when he had come to the US and to be searched. And so I just thought that was very funny, and that's just an example of how far that has gone. And of course, Almond Joy and Mounds are still in existence, although they're owned by Nestle, I believe now, and they're still one of the biggest candy bars. And so they were really responsible for creating this candy empire and supplying 5 million Mounds bars to the US Army during World War II at some point, which is probably how this German Nazi prisoner of war got a hold of them. And so from that, commercial production of food from the restaurant business and the agricultural production, you get into another type of history when it comes to Armenian food in America. And that has to do with women's guilds, the production of cookbooks, and generally speaking, culinary resilience. So this is a women's guild from Watervliet, New York, who are one of the oldest. They've been cooking, I think, for probably about over 100 years. But women in kitchens all across America, Armenian women, were responsible for taking Armenian food culture and continuing it. And a lot of guilds in churches in many cities across America were responsible for doing this and still do it today. Again, because Armenians couldn't access their ancestral lands, these kitchens became beacons of food resistance and resilience, and they were all led by women. Places like Fresno, New York, Boston, Racine, Detroit, Rhode Island, they were, and it was volunteer work, and they did it, and they started to put on picnics and bazaars and give Armenians a sense of grounding, because those places where these foods originated from were no longer accessible to Armenians. And so it was a very influential part of Armenian culinary heritage. These are some more photos. The one on the left is from a women's guild in New Britain, Connecticut. And the one on the right is a kitchen in Los Angeles. And they're both were known for making food for the bazaars and picnics that they would put on throughout the year. And these photos are from the ladies' guild that I began cooking with in Detroit, the St. John Armenian Church Ladies Guild. And you can see that they, they're even rolling their own dough. And so this goes back to what I was saying before about how Armenian cuisine is very labor intensive and is often done in groups. And even though they're third, fourth generation, these recipes essentially have not really changed from the moment that their ancestors came over to the US as refugees. So it's a very interesting type of culture, food culture, a segment of Armenian food culture in America. These are more photos from the Ladies Guild in Detroit. This is them making turshi, which is basically pickled vegetables. And you can see that it's kind of always a long line of people working together to make sure that the job gets done. Again, more photos. Sometimes the men even come and help out for the heavier jobs. The photo on the right is them rolling sarma. Again, long assembly lines and a lot of fun. And I was really fortunate enough to have this group of women really take me under their wing and teach me a lot about what their traditions meant to them. And in addition to cooking in the church kitchens, Armenian women's guilds and Armenian women's organizations started to produce cookbooks. One of the most famous cookbook is the one on the left. It's called Treasured Armenian Recipes. I'd wager to say that many Armenian households across America, if they have any cookbooks that are Armenian, it's this one on the left. It was published in 1949 by the Armenian General Benevolent Union, the Detroit Women's Chapter. And it's very poignant what they wrote in the beginning pages of the cookbook. And I think it's the kind of thing that probably at the time and often even today you wouldn't find in a cookbook. And I'll just briefly read that section to you. Anyone who has read William Saroyan's My Name is Aram is familiar with the sad visage of a transplanted Armenian, Uncle Melik, who bought a patch of California desert from a real estate shark to plant pomegranate trees, such as he cherished from his childhood in the old country is typical. It does not matter that only lizards and toads inhabited this portion of the desert. What matters is that he did not give up. He tries to plant his Armenia. The bold attempt is made. The desert must be watered, nurtured, and subdued. Perhaps, who knows, the pomegranate tree will thrive where only cactus survives. A race of people who have lived through 25 turbulent centuries does not give up trying. Our hope is high that young Armenians will seize upon these recipes, like Uncle Melik and his trees, as an heirloom and make them their own. And so I just found that really emotional because this really is kind of a way of continuing on culture. It's not just food. And that is because we have been so far removed from our roots and the food becomes a language in which to continue those traditions. The book on the right is a later version of an Armenian cookbook. I believe it's out of New Jersey. On the top, you can see it says Armenian American recipes. And that's at that point, this is when other recipes that were circulating in America at the time, like clam dip, for example, or German chocolate cake started making their way into these cookbooks. And so next to recipes of shish kebab and other kinds of Armenian food. There are American recipes too. This is from a cookbook, Armenian cookbook from Racine, Wisconsin, called Cooking Like Mama. And again, it is very fascinating to read through Armenian cookbooks because they're not just cookbooks, they're history books. Each recipe in this cookbook has the portrait and story of the woman who came up with the recipe or who transmitted the recipe. And in each and every story, you can read about the journey that they had to go through to eventually end up in Racine. On the left-hand side, you can see that Vartuhi Kaprelian lost her entire family with the exception of her brother during the 1915 genocide, made her way to France, then Argentina, then from Argentina, they arrived in the US and finally made their way to Racine, where a lot of immigrants, Armenian immigrants, were going because of jobs. And it's the same on the right-hand side. This woman was born in Bulgaria. She was orphaned during the massacres, lived in a Catholic orphanage, then immigrated to Istanbul, then went to the US. And so it's just a really beautiful book of stories and recipes from these women. And this is actually a piece I just wrote in Food and Wine magazine in the February 2021 issue. On the left-hand side is a woman named Roberta. She is from Detroit and she is an essential part of the Women's Guild in Detroit. And when I arrived in the Midwest about 5 years ago, she was one of the women who really welcomed me with open arms and let me ask a lot of persistent questions and cooked with me and told me a bit about her story. And so her story is part of a package that was published in Food and Wine this month about aunties. And Roberta became an auntie to me. And it is amazing that I got a chance to connect with them and have a chance to kind of listen to their stories and learn how to make these recipes myself. And so here's another example of me making some of those recipes. This is a famous Armenian Easter bread called choreg. And you can see the Treasured Armenian Recipes cookbook on the right. But every year in Detroit, I get together with some of my friends in Detroit and we continue to make this bread. And it really means more than just the bread itself. It's kind of just a way for us to continue those traditions. And that really brings us to the conclusion of this presentation. The project that I'm doing, which is called Dining in Diaspora, which is where all this information is from, is really kind of a way to give Armenians a place at the table, that it's with food that we're able to regenerate and that it's through this food that our story can be told. And it's a beautiful language through which to tell that story. And especially given the fact that Armenians today still continue to face displacement. And so these stories become even more important because of that reason. And one thing that I've learned doing the project is that food should never be the end of how you start exploring communities and learning about people. Your curiosity shouldn't end at the plate. It's actually where it should start. And it tells us stories about politics and immigration and history and people's cultures. And so that's what we'll end with today. And I hope you took something away from this whirlwind 100-year journey into the Armenian culinary legacy in America. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much. That was fascinating. And you know, I think you ended on a note that is pertinent to this exhibition as well. This idea of being able to tell these many stories through through culture, through this broad span of identity through the arts, right? And so whether that's culinary arts or the works that we have in this exhibition, again, A Boundless Drop to A Boundless Ocean, it's fascinating to me when I go into these galleries, the poetic ways and languages, the visual language that these artists are able to kind of draw upon from their rich heritage. And so you see that within the culinary traditions that you're also sharing with us today. And we will, I'm gonna bring up a few of the questions that have been asked of our participants, but to kind of get us started and to allow people a bit of time to ask a few more questions in the Q&A, I'm wondering if you could share maybe the most surprising story that you have encountered in this project. What is kind of...
That's a good question.
Yeah.
There are a couple, some of them, which I didn't mention in this presentation, I can talk about. So one of the most significant ones is rice-a-roni. Rice-a-roni was, as we know it, as the San Francisco treat, but actually the recipe and the idea of rice-a-roni came from a woman that the founders were renting a room from, and every night she would make this Armenian pilaf recipe, and eventually that recipe trickled into the minds of these founders, and that's how rice-a-roni was created. So it's based on an Armenian pilaf recipe by a genocide survivor who came to the US and continued to cook her food. And so that's one way, of a really surprising way, that it has permeated into American culture. Armenian food has permeated into American culture. Another very surprising thing is that Armenians were responsible for the first mass production of yogurt in America. Armenians introduced yogurt to the US, a company called Colombo Yogurt out on the East Coast, and their founders is really what set up the yogurt brands or yogurt culture in America as we know it today. Now you go to the grocery store and the yogurt shelf is like two aisles long, but back in the day, yogurt was a very new concept to Americans, and Armenians had a huge part in introducing that to the US. So those are just two places where you wouldn't necessarily think to look for that story, but that just kind of come out once you start digging.
It's fascinating. We have a couple of questions from viewers right now. One of them is just a little bit of a clarifying question, a bit more about the history of Armenians and their persecution, from Judith. What was the reason for, that's probably a vast question. She's saying, admitting that it's probably a very complicated answer, but perhaps you could explain a bit more about why Armenians were persecuted.
Yeah, that's a very complicated question. I would probably leave that for a scholar historian to kind of explain.
Sure.
But I guess I can just say that the Armenian question, as it was called, was a theme in the Ottoman Empire for a long time. And so what happened to Armenians and their annihilation was not something that happened quickly, like suddenly. It was just a thing that had been a theme that had been going on for a long time, and annihilating Armenians and exterminating them accomplished was the final goal in which that was accomplished. And it happened during the crumbling of the Ottoman Empire as well, so it's very complicated.
Sure.
I've written about it before. There's historians who have talked about it before, but if that is an interesting segment to discover, I know there's so much work that is online that can be parsed about that topic, but.
Sure. We have a few other questions as well. Somewhat related to that last one though, Vicky Chambers has shared that she has a grandfather who was born in Turkey and part of the Armenian genocide. And she remembers him having a tattoo on the inside of his wrist. Do you know anything about those marks? Like, are tattoos a marker of the genocide?
Yes, the tattoos were used as markers
in the genocide, but they were mostly used on women.
Okay.
There's actually a wonderful documentary called My Grandmother's Tattoo that explores that. In terms of a tattoo on the wrist for men, sometimes when people would make pilgrimages to Jerusalem, they would get a tattoo to mark that pilgrimage. It could be from that, but as far as the tattoos related to the genocide, I'm sure there are cases where it was male too, but what I know of is that women were the ones who were mostly marked, and it was mostly markings on the face versus the wrist. So, but that documentary is a wonderful one, My Grandmother's Tattoos tattoo, if anybody wants to check it out.
Absolutely. We have a question from our exhibition curator, Dr. Balaghi, is asking, could you talk about NBA coach and player Steve Kerr's grandfather's role in working with the Near East Relief Organization?
Yeah, I know about that story, yes. So his father or ancestors or grandfather was instrumental in working with the Near East Relief Foundation, I believe in Lebanon. And he witnessed a lot of the atrocities. He witnessed a lot of the orphanages, and that left such a huge impression on that family. I believe he wrote a book called The Lions of Marash, which details all of that history. And it's obviously something that has transferred to Steve Kerr as well. They had a huge role. I can't remember the details right now, but they were influential in that space for sure.
Sure. And question again about another individual that was mentioned in your presentation. Nancy Wolf has asked, she's made an observation that, like so many things, we are learning about the contributions of a variety of ethnic, racial, religious groups that make what we think of as quintessential American things, including food. You mentioned George Martikin impacted the food served in the army. So can you give a few more examples of that?
So I think at the time, the nutrition wasn't, I guess, up to George Martikin's standards. But, in general, he kind of changed the meals that they were eating. I think he also even, they were calling the place that they would eat the mess, they would call it the food mess. And I think he changed that word. He didn't want food to be associated with mess or something like that, that I've read. But I don't know the specifics, the specific foods he changed, but I do know that when he went in, he got to the point, he was so influential that he was at that time discussing these issues with government officials and, the army clearly. And so they let him come in and kind of bring more nutrition, I think what it was, to the army, and change their meals so that, because they were in the middle of World War II. So it was important for that to happen. I'm still kind of researching the specific meals that he had an influence on and what exactly he changed, but I have seen that he was influential with that.
Sure. We have a question from Jason, who says, you mentioned that much of the cooking is being done in groups and it's very social. So coming into the present moment, how has the pandemic affected these Armenian ladies and families that are not able to gather and make the recipes that they cherish?
Yeah. First of all, hi, Jason. It's nice to see you here. these women, the ones that I worked with in Detroit especially, cook for many, many months together. So their bazaar is around October. They start cooking in February, March for this bazaar. So as you can imagine, and for a lot of them, they're older. And so this is a very social activity for them, to get out of the house. But since that time, what the Detroit Guild has done is start to do demonstrations and put them up on YouTube so people at home can cook along. And actually, it's very helpful because when you're when you're with them, they do things so quickly and they don't obviously have the time to explain everything they're doing, that you have to be watching them 3-4 times to be able to, you know, visit them 3-4 times to be able to kind of grasp what they're doing. But the video is perfect because they're explaining exactly what they're doing. They're telling you exactly what ingredients they're using. And it's just a really great way to follow along.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah. So I think a lot of it has gone digital. You know, they're doing some Zoom classes. They're parsing that out to their, you know, church members. Me personally, it's been hard because it's very difficult cooking these things alone. I mean, I know this is very prominent in many food cultures and every food culture, you know, you cook food to enjoy it with people together and you want to cook with other people. And so it's very difficult to sometimes do these recipes and do it alone in silence. It's kind of really sad, actually. But they found creative ways and I give them a lot of credit because, as I said, they're an older community and they might not be so up to par on you know, the technology, but they've adapted amazingly to being able to put these Zoom lessons and YouTube lessons. And yeah, that's another theme, you know, like Armenians are very adaptable people. And I guess, like, you know, if I'm going to be
part of
it, I can connect it back to that, but they found a way. But I think that every single one of these guilds and whoever cooks in groups is looking forward to getting back in the kitchen. Cause really it's more than just cooking, it's fellowship and it sustains them beyond the actual food. So.
Yeah, absolutely. So those videos, is there like a repository or a channel on YouTube that you would recommend for us to explore?
For the Detroit Women's Guild, I believe that they're only sent out to their members or people who belong to the church, but there are dozens of videos that you can look on YouTube. One, I guess, more popular cook, her name is Herina. It's H-E-G-H-I-N-E-H. And she has an Armenian cooking show. She has dozens of videos, easy to follow along with if you're ever interested in cooking Armenian food. And she does a really good job in encompassing a lot of the food from different regions. Cause as I mentioned before, it kind of differs depending on where you're from, but she's a good resource to check out on YouTube.
Wonderful. And, you know, we're coming up to the end of our time. So unfortunately, we're not going to be able to answer all of these great questions, but I do want to end with one for you specifically. Any update on a Dining in Diaspora book? Any cookbook coming our way?
Yeah, the work that I've been doing with talking and researching Armenian culinary legacy in America and the diaspora is something that just doesn't seem to end. The stories I shared today were, you know, a snippet of the kind of stories that exist. And so because of that reason, I am currently working on a book proposal to tie them together and see what that entails. And when the pandemic is over, of course, to travel, to be able to go and meet a lot of these cooks and families and research these stories in places like, you know, Montana and upstate New York and even Florida, actually. So yeah, I'm hoping to put to have a book sometime.
Well, I look forward to it. This was absolutely wonderful, Liana. Thank you so much for spending your morning, our afternoon together and sharing your work with us. I know we have so many questions in the chat, but if people want to get in touch with you, the best way is through your website, diningindiaspora.com.
Yeah, or if they just Google my name, my own personal website comes up and my email is really accessible through that. And I'm happy to chat with anybody and answer more questions. And like I said, this was just a snippet of what there is out there. And I know that there's bigger questions when it comes to the genocide and, you know, the reasons why that occurred and whatnot. And I'm happy to talk about that and point people in the right direction when it comes to any questions people might have. So But thank you so much for everyone.
Thank you, Liana. Thank you so much for joining us today. You are our first speaker in this series, Cultural Conversations. And so I encourage you, everyone who is listening, yes, to follow Liana's project. Also to check out our website, omart.me/boundlessprograms, for more information about events and programming that is related to this current exhibition, A Boundless Drop to a Boundless Ocean. All right, well, thank you again. I hope everyone enjoys the rest of your Sunday.
Thank you. Bye.